Welcome back to the lecture on digital image processing. In this lecture, I will be focusing on fundamental steps in digital image processing, and then components of image processing system, and finally human visual system structure of the eye. Okay, let's begin. The previous slide, we conclude the discussion on examples of image processing and various light sources or illumination sources for our digital images and its examples. Now we'll be studying about fundamental steps in digital image processing. So as you can see here, it starts with image acquisition of the problem domain. Problem domain can be outside world problem, can be a scenery or a scanning document which needs to be scanned, anything in the outside world. And first step is to acquire that image using a sensor, and then we have enhancement, restoration processing, wavelet and multi-resolution processing, compression and morphological processing. And you can note here that the outputs of these processes generally are images. So here for these blocks, the input is an image and output is also an image. But the remaining blocks from this one, this morphological, can map to both the things: morphological, segmentation, representation and description, and object recognition. So outputs of these processes generally are image attributes. So we'll take a look at them one by one from the next slide. Let's switch over to this view so that explanation becomes a bit easier. So in the first step of image acquisition, we are capturing the scene element using the imaging system. We have already seen this image, so just this is a recall of the concept. So we have analog image captured, and we perform A to D conversion, and we get a digital representation. So this is the image acquisition. We'll have a discussion about image acquisition techniques in detail later. Next part is image enhancement. So you can see the input image is blurry, and then we can use the image enhancement techniques to make it more clear. We are basically enhancing the contrast here. Next is image restoration. In image restoration, we know what type of degradation has taken place, and we try to restore the image to its clean form or original form. So in this image, you can see there's a grid-like structure, grid-like noise added in the image, and after you perform restoration, that grid-like structure is removed and you end up with a clear image. So if you go for frequency domain filtering, you will get a clear output like this. Let's first understand the difference between enhancement and restoration. Enhancement is a subjective process, and here a priori knowledge about degradation is not a must, and sometimes there is no degradation also. And the procedures here are heuristic and take advantage of psychological aspects of human visual system. Basically, enhancement depends on the person who is doing it. Say one fellow does it and says, okay, that much enhancement is enough, it looks good, and you can see, I can clearly see the objects. Some other person may look at the enhanced image and say, no, this much of enhancement is still not enough, we have to do more. So it depends on the user who is doing the processing. But restoration, on the other hand, has clear set goals. That means it's an objective process, and images are degraded, and we know the underlying degradation functions, and we try to recover the images by using the knowledge about the degradation. So this is the major difference between enhancement and restoration. Enhancement is subjective in nature, restoration is objective in nature. Next, Before we perform other advanced operations, we should understand what are wavelets. So, brief introduction. Wavelets are foundation for representing images in various degrees of resolution, low resolution to high resolution. We can represent images using wavelets, and they are used in data compression and pyramidal representation. So we'll have a detailed discussion on wavelets in module 4. Next block is the morphological processing block, and here we try to recover the missing shape or object, or try to join something, join missing parts using morphological operators and mathematical equations. And here you can see some parts of the some lines in the fingerprint are missing, so we can use the morphological processes to join them. And you can see a representation here, mathematical equations. So basically we are using set operators like intersection, union, inclusion, and complement to perform morphological operations. So here the input is a binary image and a structuring element, and we combine them using a set operator. They process objects in the input image based on characteristics of its shape, which are encoded in the structuring elements, and we'll be discussing on this aspect in fourth module. Next block is the segmentation block. Here the idea is to identify the foreground and the background. And here in this example, there's a shape and you can see the shadow in the background. And by using segmentation, we are clearly identifying the object in the foreground. And we have completely eliminated the shadow. So the segmentation has clearly separated the foreground from the background. So all in all, image segmentation is the process of partitioning a digital image into multiple segments. It could be set of pixels, also known as image objects. And image segmentation is typically used to locate objects and boundaries in images like lines, curves, etc. Typically the first step in any automated computer vision application is the segmentation process, and we have the next block to follow that, which is the representation and description. And here you can see we are creating boundaries around the objects, and we are identifying the shapes here in representation and description. So in representation and description, we make a decision whether the data should be represented as a boundary or as a complete region. So in boundary representation, we focus on the external shape, shape characteristics such as corners and inflections. And in region representation, we focus on internal properties such as textures or skeleton shape. And we have the object recognition block, which is very important block for many advanced processes. So in this example, you can see we are separating iris flower segregation. So based on the petal length, basically it depends on the understanding of the image, and we label the blocks which are described in the previous section. Okay, so what happens here is in recognition, it is a process that assigns a label on object based on the information provided by its descriptors. So in the previous block we studied about image representation and description. So it the object recognition part assigns the label to those descriptors. It is one of the most important applications of computer vision, machine learning, and deep learning. So it, this object recognition makes it possible to identify a person or a car or a number plate. So basically scene understanding is made possible because of object recognition. The goal of this is to teach machines to understand the content of an image just like humans do. Image compression is very vital because we need to save our storage space. If the image takes up lots of space, then basically you're wasting your storage. So we need to find a way to compress the image. And nowadays, image size is quite huge. Lots of pixels are there in an image. So if we can compress them and store them in an efficient way, then it will be a bonus. So there are several image formats like JPEG, which is a compressed format, which is a lossy compression, and we have PNG compression and a PNG format, which is a lossless compression. So there are other formats like TIFF or GIF. Okay, they have their own formats, but all these things make use of cosine transform or wavelet transform to compress the images. Color image processing. So humans can see around 253 shades of gray, but they can identify millions of color shades of color, and it is evident from this example here. So this is a grayscale image of an object, and see, with this image it's very little information available. Like, you cannot make out more regions here, but if you go for color image processing, you can label different grayscale into different color, and this is a false colored image, and it you can make out lots of areas in this with the different color. Identification is very easy with this. So this is the advantage of color image processing. Components of an image processing system. So this block diagram gives you an overview of a typical image processing system. It all begins with this problem domain, which could be outside scenery or a person waiting for his passport pic or a document which needs to be scanned. So you need an image sensor to do that, which is inside a imaging system. You have a lens and then image sensor arrangement to capture the image. So image sensors give analog output, okay, which is proportional to the light falling on the sensor. So this analog signal should be converted into digital signal. So that is done by the specialized image processing hardware, and all other processing is basic processing is done by this hardware. And then this signal needs to be further refined or enhanced by the computer. Okay, so we have the computer set up here, and after you do all the post processing and all, you need to save the file. So you need a mass storage device. It could be your pen drive or a SD card or any storage device. And for some computers or some mobile phones or cameras, you have additional image processing software embedded, so which can identify a person or a face and a smile, okay, and give a real-time feedback or real-time display of what it is detecting, and that can be displayed using image displays, and then you can take the hard copy using a printer, and you can have the computer or your system connected to a network. Let's learn about aspects of human vision by learning about the structure of the human eye. So many terms you are familiar with, like retina, and lens you are familiar with, and iris you might have heard about. Okay, so this is the ciliary body here, and the ciliary muscles are there. In the next image I'll show you in depth, and the pupil transparent part, and the cornea is the outer shell, and sclera is there, choroid is there, and this inner lining is called the retina. This is the retina part, and if you zoom into this square here, if you zoom into this, and this is what you get. Okay, so retina is basically composed of cones and rods. and each cone is having its own nerve ending, and a group of rods are having their own nerve endings. So these cones and rods in the retina are the light sensing elements. Okay, so we'll switch over to a simplified view, which is there in the textbook in the next slide. This is a more detailed view of the structure of the human eye, and you can see the cornea is the outer layer, and we have the iris here, and then ciliary muscles. Iris gives the color to the eye, whether it's a green eye or blue or brown or black, whatever you call, is because of the iris. And then the ciliary muscles here control the dimensions of the lens. Okay, lens basically lets the light in, and iris controls the amount of exposure of the lens. Okay, how much it should be open, and lens dimension makes it focus on the particular object. Okay, so lens is for focusing, and so there is a visual axis. You can see visual axis. This is the center of the eye, and it connects to this part, fovea. We call this as fovea. And the fovea is very important for us, because in the fovea we have more number of cones, more cones are there in fovea, and the inner layer is called retina. Okay, all the inner lining is called retina, and so from this part all the way till this part we have retina, right? And in this part you can see it's marked as fovea, and some degrees to the left of fovea you can see the blind spot where the nerve and sheath meet, means the nerve and nerve connection to the brain is connected here. Okay, in this part. Okay, so this is the nerve ending, and the outer layer, sclera, is depicted, choroid is there. Okay, so this is the structure of the human eye. This graph illustrates the distribution of cones and rods in the human eye, and as you can see the cones are represented by the solid line and rods are represented by the dotted line, and there are more number of rods, okay, than the cones. Okay, these are rods, and this solid line here, this one is the cones. Okay, and cones are located in the middle on the visual axis where the fovea is present. Okay, and so cones are responsible for color vision. Cones are for color, and rods are for intensity or black and white vision. Okay, so cone vision is called as photopic vision, and rod vision is called as ascotopic vision. Okay, and on the blind spot you can see 20 degrees left of fovea you have the blind spot, and here you cannot see anything in this blind spot. Okay, means if the light falls on that, you won't be able to see the object. Okay, we'll do a small experiment to illustrate that or understand what is blind spot. So to summarize, the lens focuses light from objects onto retina. The retina is covered with light receptors called cones and rods. Cones are 6 to 7 million in number, and rods are 75 to 150 million in numbers. It's huge difference. Okay, more number of rods are present in the human eye, and cones are concentrated around fovea. See, cones are centered around the fovea and are very sensitive to color, and the human can resolve more details in color because each cone is connected to its own nerve end. Okay, cones are having dedicated nerve endings. Okay, muscles controlling the eye rotate the eyeball until the image of the object of interest falls on the fovea. That is how we view the things. And a cone vision, as I mentioned, cone vision is called photopic or bright light vision. Rods are more spread out and are sensitive to low levels of illumination. As you saw in the image, it's spread all along the retina throughout the inner lining of the eye. And rods serve to give general overall picture of the field of view. And they are not involved in color vision and are sensitive to low levels of illumination. And you can observe the things that you see in daylight appear fully colorful, like trees or any object outside or inside. But after the sunset, when it's night, if there is a moonlight, you can see only black and white. Only in black and white, you cannot see any color. Okay, that is because under dim light conditions, rod vision is under play. Okay, cones are no longer in the picture, and you cannot see color. Okay, so for cone vision, you need more light intensity. Okay, like a broad daylight or a bright illuminated room. As the light gets darker and darker, rods take over and basically becomes a rod vision, and this phenomena is called as scotopic or dim light vision. So rod vision, the vision because of rods, is called scotopic vision. Okay, so this is about the basics. You can check the blind spot in human eye by doing this experiment. So draw the image like this one, dot and cross 6 inches apart, okay, on a white paper, 6 inches apart. Make it darker, okay, thick and dark dot and cross. Close your right eye and focus on the cross with your left eye. Hold the image about 20 inches away from your face and move it slowly towards you. The dot should disappear, okay, as you observe, okay, from your peripheral vision, the dot will disappear. Okay, so you can pause the video here and do the experiment and continue to the next part. So formation of image in the eye. So muscles within the eye can be used to change the shape of the lens, allowing us to focus on objects that are linear or far away. An image is focused onto retina, causing rods and cones to become excited, which ultimately sends signals to the brain. So the processing happens in the brain. The eye basically is like your sensing device, but the processor is the brain. Okay, and see, this is how object forms. Typically, this is a coconut tree, 15 meters tall, and if the person is standing at 100 meters distance, and this is how the image falls on his eye. So you can do the math and you can calculate around 8 mm you will get. Okay, so this inverted image, so image is always inverted, and this is the distance between the lens and the retina. Okay, 17 mm. So this is how we see things. So in this lecture, we looked at fundamental steps in digital image processing, components of an image processing system, and the human visual system. Basically, we learned about the structure of the human eye. In the next lecture, we'll learn about brightness adaptation and discrimination, and how we acquire images onto a image processing system. Okay, see you at the next lecture. Thank you.